I want to take this time to give you all a small taste of the topics that we cover in the Sustainability Studies program here at UIW. When I introduce students to sustainability, which is an effort to meet the demands of the present without compromising future generations' needs, I describe it as a wicked problem or a socially complex issue with no single clear solution, but ongoing, contradictory, and unpredictable challenges. Because I study and teach in the English department, I also bring my knowledge of narrative to bear on this topic. To frame something as narrative helps people to break out of conventional patterns of thought, because narratives have surprises, twists, and turns, and are subject to wildly differing interpretations. Well, some may come to my classes thinking all is hopeless, there's nothing we can realistically do to save the planet. I use class time to let them discover that there are multiple readings of the story of humanity's relationship to the natural world. And here's one way that I do that, by introducing them to biochar. What is that? You're probably thinking. The scientific answer, it is a type of charcoal produced through pyrolysis, which is low oxygen burning that actually locks in carbon. When we think of burning, we often think of incineration, which turns organic matter to ash and releases carbon dioxide, that pesky greenhouse gas that adds to that thick blanket of greenhouse gases already heating the planet. Pyrolysis, on the other hand, sequesters almost four times as much carbon dioxide as would have been released through incineration. And the biochar it creates continues to absorb CO2 for hundreds of years. Since biochar is a type of charcoal, it's very porous. It has a large surface area. It can absorb far more than its weight in water, reducing water usage in agriculture when applied to soil. It also adsorbs lead from soils and heavy metals from soils. Because it locks in that carbon, biochar is a potent and long-lasting fertilizer. It also builds up topsoil. This means it can combat desertification, soil erosion, flash flooding. And remember, flash flooding occurs not because of too much water, but because of too little water infiltration into the soil. The benefits of biochar are pretty much endless. They can go on and on, as this slide will show you. As one researcher puts it, biochar is like reverse coal mining. I mean, look at all those benefits. This is wonderful. And the science stuff is fascinating. I could talk about this for hours, but that's not what my speech is about today. So for today, I want to say that I challenge students to see the other dimensions of biochar. For instance, it appeals to organizations that are seeking to get carbon credits or carbon offsets to offset the carbon that they emit into the air. Currently, tree planting is one of the main ways that large polluters offset their emissions. But recent research has shown, well, tree planting has probably failed to accomplish that goal of pulling as much carbon out of the air as companies are putting into it. This threatens the fledgling carbon credit market designed to mitigate the effects of industrial emissions, with dire consequences for not only the sustainable businesses that need these credits, but also people and planet. And I want to stop here and dwell on those three terms. They're very significant for sustainability and for biochar: people, planet, profit. Often referred to as the three P's or the triple bottom line, these are the three main components of sustainability. Basically, socioeconomic development is sustainable only when people are supported as much as the planet is and as much as economic growth is. Sustainability is compromised, though, when profits are sought at the expense of human or environmental flourishing. And we often see this, right? We often see profits placed above all else, or human needs in conflict with the rhythms of nature, which is why sustainability is such a wicked problem. But nothing is sustainable for humans and the environment now and into the future without harmony between people, planet, and profit. Increasingly, biochar is seen as an alternative to tree planting for those aforementioned carbon offsets. About 40% of all offsets sold in 2022 were for biochar, and that number is set to grow dramatically, according to the director of the United States Biochar Initiative, which is a biochar trade group. And yes, biochar has lobbyists. And so you may be asking yourself, why haven't I heard of this? And What are those lobbyists being paid to do? Is it new? Is this a new invention? Short answer is no. Biochar has been around for quite a while. Indigenous farmers in Brazil pyrolyzed agricultural and food waste so often and effectively that even after European colonization, soil in the Amazon actively drew carbon from the air without human intervention. And on this, you can see what they called it. The colonists called it terra preta, or black earth. And you can see on the other side of the slide, that is normal Amazon soil, which is more heavily clay soil. So they thought this was kind of a miracle, that the soil was self-producing and was so productive without any human intervention. They didn't realize that it was the biochar that was doing it. So now you're probably thinking, okay, well, this just seems like a really complicated thing. It's hard to make, right? Well, we can produce biochar from nearly any type of organic matter. Its feedstock is usually agricultural and municipal waste, but any device that burns organics can be retrofitted to pyrolyze biomass, or in layman's terms, any fire pit, barbecue, kiln, can make biochar out of anything in your growing in your backyard or from any of your kitchen scraps. We already have a large cottage industry of devices that produce both small and large scale biochar. And the devices that they use are pretty diverse. There's flame curtain kilns, earth pits, fire pits, retort kilns, toplit updraft gasifiers, and tube furnaces. And it's only a small sampling of the options up on the screen. These devices can even pyrolyze without releasing smoke into the air. I have students in my courses brainstorm how to increase public perception, how to incentivize policy changes vis-a-vis biochar. I ask them, how can you expand the industry when it lacks upfront capital? Or how do we get biochar into farmers' hands when the price is too high? A wicked problem indeed. I begin these discussions by noting that the narrative of biochar would be improved through greater alignment with the environmental justice movement, which started in the late 1970s to address a statistical fact. People who live and work in America's most polluted environments are disproportionately poor Americans, Black Americans, Hispanics and Latinos, indigenous groups, and immigrant communities. It's nothing more than environmental racism. In 1978, Linda McKeever filed the first lawsuit to challenge environmental racism, and she used civil rights law to do this. Her lawsuit focused on the placement of garbage dumps in Houston. Even though Black Houstonians created less than 20% of the city's waste, 75% of the waste produced in the city went to landfills sited right up next to the fence lines of neighborhoods that were predominantly made up of Black Americans. Her initial challenge failed in court, but she went on to numerous legal successes and laid the groundwork for our current framework that protects underserved communities. Her husband, Dr. Robert Bullard, helped compile research, and he became one of the leading American scholars of environmental justice, if not the leading American scholar. Centering environmental justice in the conversation about biochar centers people too. And so far, that conversation has predominantly been about the planet, which is only one of those three P's. So when we say that biochar sequesters carbon from the air, that's great. That's a benefit for the planet. To add people into the conversation, all we need to say is that translates into more affordable, nutritious food in America's food deserts, which are underserved communities that lack access to fresh, healthy food, another product of environmental racism. Or when we say biochar can absorb lead and other heavy metals, let's translate that to biochar makes for safe playgrounds in cities whose soil is full of heavy metals. This makes explicit biochar's ability to counter environmental injustices, which can improve public perception and policy. And without those policy changes, the scaling up is not going to have a happy ending. Of the top 50 American companies by revenue, a majority receive generous subsidies and policy benefits. So to expand that public knowledge, which then will spur those policy changes, we need to make the narrative of biochar more inclusive. It also has to appeal to an audience of policymakers. So for instance, in the United States, roughly 10 states currently offer rebates for recycling aluminum cans. And everybody in America knows about this, even if you don't live in those 10 states. Meanwhile, scrapyards and for-profit recycling companies incentivize recycling in their own ways. Why don't we have a biochar scrapyard, as one of my colleagues suggested? Think about it. Municipalities could offer rebates for DIY biochar. They could subsidize purchase of at-home biochar units. Or they could dedicate the biomass collected by city employees to municipal-scale biochar produced either by the city or a private entity, which would save the city's money, saving money on fertilizer, topsoil, flood control, climate resilience initiatives, and perhaps most importantly, that burdensome labor cost of disposing of all of that biomass. And all the while, they're rewarding taxpayers for doing what they would have done anyway. Barbecuing, grilling, gathering with friends around a campfire. This is an easy way to simultaneously support people, planet, and profit. And it is based on a tried and true method of sustainable development practiced in America for decades. So this is just one example of the lessons that I teach and how we can find solutions to the wicked problem of finding a sustainable way of life in the 21st century. It's hard, onerous work. And I want to say to you what I say to my students. Remember the lessons of history's equal rights movements. Women in America began advocating for suffrage over 70 years before the 19th Amendment became law in 1920. Some who began that movement did not live to see that day, but their work made the world a better place for future generations. That's the goal of sustainability in general, and from my perspective, biochar in particular. But it can only be reached if tomorrow's leaders have something that I believe is best taught in the liberal arts classroom. Courage. Enthusiasm can only get us so far. We have to choose to behave ethically despite uncertainty, which is perhaps the truest sign of wisdom. Lessons in history, philosophy, English, and other disciplines are uniquely suited to prepare students to have that courage to act for the betterment of others, even in the face of opposition from those with differing opinions, and even in the face of seemingly insurmountable challenges. Thank you.